Good afternoon, Professor Subramaniam, sir.
Sir, namaste, namaste, sir. Good afternoon.
Yes, sir. Good afternoon, sir, and welcome to our webinar, sir.
Thank you very much.
It's a great pleasure to have you in our midst, sir.
Yeah,
as today's resource person. And so good afternoon, everyone. Let us begin the afternoon session. Of course, post-lunch session is generally a bit challenging, sir. So our resource person today is Professor K.N. Subramania, Principal of RV College of Engineering, Bangalore. Professor Subramania has teaching experience of 24 years and 4 years of research experience. And Professor Subramania's areas of interest include supply chain management, lean manufacturing, operations management, e-enterprise modeling, simulation modeling and analysis, quality management, information system design, decision sciences, applied agronomics, systems engineering, and strategic management, and you name a few. Sir has has project guided 65 undergraduate students, postgraduate students as well. Sir has the publications in the national journals, numbering 20, in the international journals, 27 publications, and national conferences publications, 25, international conference publications, 56, and sir has delivered talks, 20 talks have been delivered. So welcome, sir. And sir's topic today is new education policy 2020 and experiential learning. We look forward to your talk, sir. And welcome to our webinar, sir. The stage is all yours, sir.
Thank you. 1 minute, I will share my PPT and then start.
Sure, sir.
Hope I'm audible.
Yes, sir. Yes.
And my slides are visible.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes.
So at any point of time, if I'm not audible or my slides may not be moving, you can inform me so that we'll make the necessary adjustments here. Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to share some of my thoughts. And I hope participants have got a lot of benefits since yesterday on the National Education Policy 2020. I'm one of a very lucky person to be there. From the beginning, from 2017 onwards in the National Education Policy Committee used to call us here in Bangalore to share some of our thoughts also. In fact, in the full document of NEP, my name is also there as a part of the contributor to this National Education Policy. So with that note, I'm sure that many of you would have already clarified with a lot of things in the National Education Policy. And what is a framework, why it has been done, what is expected out of us and all those things. But my focus would be a little bit into the next level, because policy has been very good, but now it's a time for us to implement. So how we are going to implement is very, very important. In fact, Karnataka is the first state to implement the new education policy. And we have already made our first year syllabus. And in fact, from next coming Monday, we are implementing the first year syllabus as per the new education policy. So the highlights of that policy is that we have a 1 credit course on Indian knowledge system in the first year, and also 1 credit course on yoga practice as a practicals in the first year. So these are the two courses which we have introduced in the first year itself. In the second, third, and final year, we'll be introducing universal human values, Indian knowledge system as an elective. We have a lot of things in pipeline, apart from liberal arts, integrating with the technology. So these are some of the things, and also making into a lot of skill-based laboratories and experiential learning methods, which I'm going to focus today. I'm sure all of you are from degree college. I'm sure there are, it could be generally 3 years course, but if you are giving honors, it will be 4 years course. We are doing a 4 years engineering course, but the methods what you are supposed to use, it doesn't matter whether you are doing for engineering, commerce, management, it should not matter. So I am going to inform you that what all the methods we are trying to look into it and what will be the impact on the outcome-based education. As you know that when people went for NAC and NBA accreditation quite sometimes back, India is also a member of the Washington Accord. And as per that, we have started long time back, maybe one decade back, the outcome-based education, because we are an autonomous institution and we have been following scrupulously the outcome-based education for more than a decade actually from now. So we have introduced some of the methods of experiential learning. I thought I will share, this is where the faculty have to work a lot. So that would be my focus today. I may not go into a lot of details in the new education policy because a lot of people since yesterday would have told you, but I have taken one specific thing how we should try to improve upon. Because at the end of the day, even though it's a student-centric education, faculty is a main nucleus according to me. If we don't change, if we don't try to help the next generation, then whatever we talk in the policy will be only in books. So it's a time for us to implement. So let me look into some of the important aspects. If you look into outcome-based education, it is precisely talking about what the student should be able to do after he completes his engineering is typically what is outcome-based education. For that, the next one is the curriculum. If you want to do that, are we really whole of our curriculum is outcome-based or totally Michaelis system of education which are doing for a long time? Is there any outcome which you are setting for every course? It's not just writing COs and POs or course outcomes or the program outcomes. Real meaning of this, are we in a position to do it, is on the outcome-based curriculum. Then are we really doing outcome-based teaching learning? These are all the things which you have to question as a faculty. Every faculty in their own course, these four steps have to be looked into. Are we really doing outcome-based assessment? Or we are trying to check for the memory only, asking for derivations, asking for simple problems, asking for definitions. So if a student can mug up the things, he can still get 90 out of 100, but he might not have understood the subjects at all. So is that way we are doing, or our assessment methods are good? So this is a whole lot of things which you have to look into, which is of course in line with national education policy. All these things go hand in hand. So each of our faculty have to look into these things when you are doing a curriculum design. Are you really doing these things? Let us try to, I'm not trying to find fault with anybody here, but we have all been stuck up, including me, for a memory-based education system for more than 250, 300 years. And now a time has come that in every activity I do, is there an outcome achieved by a student or not? We are supposed to measure it. So is that measure is there or not? At every stage of education, curriculum, teaching, learning, and assessment is the one which you have to look into. In order to make this outcome-based education more effective, and also the learning of a student should be much better, what we are supposed to do is that today, apart from outcome-based education, we also talk about digital technologies. I'm sure the way we are doing now in the platform of Zoom shows that we are using technology. But are we using the technology of available technology on all these fronts, like say online class conduction tools? I'm sure this is the only one which you are using. It could be Google Meet or it could be WebEx or whatever it is. This we have been using it. But are we really doing the learning management tools, like say Google Sites, Easy Class, Canvas? Canvas is done by Stanford University. It is very good actually. All the faculty can use this and store their whole material. As you store in a file, you can store all your details starting from your attendance to material, to quizzes, to questions, to the question papers, all the assignments, everything could be put in one place using a learning management tool. Screen recorders. Are we using really the Cam Studios or screenshots very effectively? This is not for my personal use. It is for the teaching the students how we are making our life very easy is the one which I have to look into. Then there are a lot of innovative teaching tools. It could be Flickr, YouTube, Geopardy. In fact, all those things can be used for conduction of the quizzes, conduction of the tests, then having a good videos in a particular topic, all these things are already available. Then online assessment tools like say Moodle, Quibblo, Socrative, and Google Forums, wherein you can ask in every class. Actually, we can start conducting the quizzes. There's one more thing called as a Mentimeter. It's a very beautiful tool which people can use to see that every day the assessment could be done. I think we are all stuck up with the discrete level of assessment. One test, final examination. And if you take last 5 years examination, there is a lot of repetition of more than 60% of the questions. And that's the way it is. So, but here, if a faculty is very imaginative, he can go on to, creating lot of questions and try to make use of these digital technologies is a one more thing which you have to look into while you are trying to implement the outcome-based education. Then the next one is how do you measure it? These are all the things which are measured through something called the Bloom's taxonomy. So if you look into, there are 6 levels in the Bloom's taxonomy. I'm not sure whether the science and commerce colleges are using this or not, but in engineering institutions, we've already started making use of these things for more than 15 years. We have been using this Bloom's taxonomy levels. This is very much helpful when people are setting up the question papers. As you know, that if you go from down top, the first level is remembering, understanding. In fact, whole of our questions, by and large, would be only the first 2 levels in the examination or the test. You have to remember, you have to understand. By and large, you can have application, that's all. Application will also be not there. It will be only textbook problem put into the examination. But the next, these 3 are called as a lower order skills, which have been done for a long time. But there are higher order skills of analyzing, evaluating, and creating. Can your student do a good product? Can your student do a good financial system? Can you develop a good HR strategy, which is required for the present day? Can your student design an app for your whole of the financial function, which is a new business altogether? So all these are the things which comes under creation stage. I think this is what is expected today. If you want to become self-reliant India or Atmanirbhar Bharat, people are looking for creation of products, process, and the systems. So are we trying to build these to our students whenever we are doing is one more thing which you have to look into. So these are the 6 levels we have in remembering, understanding, applying, which we have been doing for a whole of our system has been the first 3 levels only. But the next 3 levels we have to move into, even in fact, the national education policy, outcome-based education, all these people only talk about these things. So this is another thing. So you remember, I told 3 things now. One is outcome-based education. Next one is the digital technology. And the next one is the Bloom's taxonomy levels. All these are the things which faculty have to study thoroughly. The Bloom, the first taxonomy levels came somewhere during 1956. But this is a revised one which came in 2001. And across the world, many universities, including many of Indian universities, Indian institutions also use Bloom's taxonomy levels. So if you use these levels and try to make a channelizing our curriculum, so that the understanding of a student would be much better. So these are the 3 things I'm looking at. So this is all from our side, but whole of our education, the teaching learning process, how is it done? It's only a one-way communication. Whatever I'm doing now, in fact, I'm not using a blackboard, I'm using a PPT, but it's a one-way communication. You're all listening, I'm talking. I think this we have been doing for more than 70, 80, 100 years, but have you looked into, if there are, I am not sure how many are there here, maybe around 40 people are there. All the 40 people, can they understand all the things in the same level? Or can they understand these things in a different level? At any point of time, have you looked into it? Similarly, I have 100 students in a class. We do the same kind of a teaching. But how do you know that every student understands in this thing or not? This we are not looked into. So now, in fact, next slide, what I'm going to show is very, very important. In every class, doing understanding a learning style of a student would be very difficult. But what I feel is, whenever you're giving assignments, whenever you're asking students to do certain things, can we use these learning styles? Learning styles, in fact, there are 4 main categories. Under each category, there are 2 categories. So first kind of a learners are called sensing and intuitive learners. What are the sensing learners? Like learning facts, dislike complications and surprises, patient with details and good in at memorization, and they are practical. Intuitive learners are what? Like to discover the probability, possibilities, tend to work faster, better at grasping the new concepts and innovative. Today, whole startups are looking for these kinds of intuitive learners. So are we really categorizing, if there are 100 students, are we categorizing the students under all these headings? I am not sure we are doing it. So visual and verbal learners. Visual learners are best remember what they see, like pictures, diagrams, films, and demonstrations. I am sure it's not just the students, even among the faculty who are listening today, you can categorize yourself into some of this category. That's how the learning styles are going to. This has been done long time back, but the primary schools are much better than us in following all those things. But when it comes to the higher education, we are simply doing a one-way communication for a long time. So what happens is the learnability of all the students are not right here. So can you look into a verbal learner is best remembering the words. Written and spoken explanations he is very good at. These are the two categories. Other two categories are active and reflective learners. So active learners are those learn best by doing something active with it. In fact, this is precisely what we are looking at the experiential learning. You have to make them do things is an active learning method. So almost all the experiential learning methods fall under this category. Let us try it out and see how they work, like group work. So we should also try to encourage students to do a lot of group work. Generally, group work means we try to do in the higher semesters for a project work. It need not be. From first year only, from first class only, can I make into groups and ask the students to do it is very important. Next, reflective learners. Learn best by thinking about it quietly first. Let us think it through first, prefer working alone. There are certain, in fact, this is a problem with the top learners. You ask a top student, he's extraordinary and he may not join with others. But he is very good in thinking alone and doing, in fact, if you take many of the Nobel laureates would be of this category. But today, even the Nobel laureates have become active learners or a team learners. But otherwise, if you take 1950s, 60s, 70s, individually people used to get Nobel Prize. So all these are the people who would like to work and make some difference in the society. Sequential and global learners. So gain understanding in steps, follow steps to find out the solutions and the logical thinking they are good at. Whereas global learners absorb information randomly, then suddenly get it, can solve complex problems quickly, but not able to explain how they did it. So these are called as global learners. So what the world is expecting today? They're expecting intuitive learners, visual learners, active learners, and global learners. This is the combination which people are looking for in one person. Whatever I'm giving here is an ideal situation, but a student can have more than one or two combination of these things. So are we really classifying the students as per this? So my request to all the faculty, in fact, you go to Google and find out how to find out active learners, reflective learners. There are a lot of psychometric tests are available. If you can go there and give it, you yourself do first, then you'll come to know what is your actually mode of learning. You yourself will understand. Then ask the students, send this Google forums and ask them to do it. Then you'll realize that what kind of learners they are. So when once you come to know that, then you can give the similar jobs for them to do it. You can group all active learners together, all reflective learners together, global learners together, and the kind of activities they can do would be very much interesting. Otherwise, what's happening? A student is not interested in mathematical way of looking at things. You ask him to do mathematical way. Other fellow is very artistic in nature. You ask him to do mathematics. So all wrong things should be doing as long as we don't identify the learning style of a student. So I hope I'm not confusing. I'm trying to give the basic fundamentals if you want to go into experiential learning. So the first level, again, I'll repeat, was an outcome-based education. Then when outcome-based education is learned, then we have to move into the blended learning and the online learning. Afterwards, we have seen the Bloom's taxonomy levels, which are all the systemic way of doing it. But now the learning style is going to come into picture. So this is on the student side. If you can try to do all those things, then experiential learning is going to become very, very easy. So let me from next slide onwards, of course, before that, what is expected by the higher education students today from the industry, what is expected? Learning style is how a student has to learn, but industry expects all these skills, 21st century skills, called as critical thinking, creativity, collaboration, and communication. Then information literacy, media literacy, and the technology literacy. Let me tell you, don't think this is only for professional students. This could be for an art student, it could be for a science student, it could be for a commerce student, it could be for an engineering student. These things apply to everybody. So don't think it's only for a certain sector of students. Then life skills, flexibility, leadership, initiative, productivity, and the social skills. All these are the 21st century skills. I'm sure you also would have, somebody would have told you, this is there in the national education policy also. So 21st century skills would be the most important thing if people have to learn, and students have to be employable in industry is what is expected. One side is the learning style, other style is achieving the 21st century skills with a focus on the outcome-based education. So if you want to do all those things, apart from your regular teaching, which will be by and large a classroom kind of a teaching what we are doing, my sincere request to all the faculty is, if you are handling for 50 hours a particular course, in my college we have already started doing that. I don't want faculty to teach all 50 hours. I want them to teach only for 15 to 20 hours. And in 30 hours, they have to work with the students in the class itself. If you can try to, how to do that is through your experiential learning methods, which will be the subject matter what I have taken today. So this is the prelude I wanted to give you before going to the experiential learning. So I'm sure some of you would have heard called cycle of experiential learning. So what is expected here? In an experiential learning, it will have four steps. Concrete experience. That means engaging directly in the authentic situation. Put yourself, push them into the waters. That's what they say. He may not be knowing swimming. Just push them into the water. Like that experiential learning is, as long as you don't experience, then what happens is you have a lot of imaginations, lot of, let us say, assumptions about a system. But you start doing it, then things become very easy. So that is the first step called as a concrete experience. Engage directly in the authentic situation. Then the reflective observations. Noticing what happened and relating to the past experience and conceptual understanding will be helpful for students learning in a better way. Then abstract conceptualization. Distilling perceptions into abstract concepts. See, typically what happens in experiential learning, I may have done a laptop. Now I want to do a mobile phone. How should I do it? So now what happens? What all the concrete experience and reflective observation I have? Now I'm going to conceptualize about a mobile phone. Then you do the experimentation, testing the new ideas, honing skills in a new experience. So you can do with the existing one. Based on the existing experience, you can also try to look into a new experience. This is called cycle of experiential learning model, which is very, very popular and people use across the world. Many universities use this four-step methodology. Fine, if we can try to do, in fact, for this, even faculty have to put in a lot of effort. It's not that just giving it to the students, our job is done. In fact, if a student works for 10 hours, faculty has to work for 100 hours if you want to go into the experiential learning mode. So these are the steps involved or the principles involved in the experiential learning. So now in our college, I have identified personally 50 methods of experiential learning. Many things you may be doing it, but you may not be doing in a channelized way. So I'm going to list under various headings. In fact, as I've already told you, learning by doing is experiential learning. In fact, there is one statement called as, we are teaching, are they learning? It's a simple statement all of us have to look into every day. We are teaching, are they learning? We say that I completed the syllabus. In fact, many people say that I have covered the syllabus. But for such faculty, I always say, don't cover the syllabus, uncover the syllabus. I think that has to be done. I think covering the syllabus, covering the number of units, writing the examination, but at the end of the course, you ask anything to a student, you may not be very confident about answering things. So that means, where is the problem? At the end of the semester or a year, faculty is unhappy stating that the students are not learned, and student is unhappy stating that he has not learned anything. So we may have to find out the different ways of looking into it. One such method is an experiential learning way of learning. So I have categorized all my experiential learning methods into 5 categories. One is course augmentation and methods. In fact, what are the things I am listing? All the things cannot be done for one course or one subject. Let us say in a BCom, 3 years course, you have some 20 subjects. All the methods which I'm going to tell you, in all the 20 subjects put together in 3 years, if he can learn, then he can make a better professional. That's the intention. So first categorization is the course augmentation. Whatever the course, let us say somebody is teaching financial management, how you are going to augment his learning? You are doing anyway in the class, the syllabus, but you have to augment him. I don't know how many of you give him a balance sheet of a company and ask him to analyze or her analyze the things. Are we giving that balance sheet is not just in the textbook. You ask them to browse, because all the public limited companies will put their balance sheets in the websites itself. Ask them to go and study the balance sheet and submit a report. That will be a very, very good experiential learning. Are we doing that? Otherwise, we take some books from Prasanna Chandra or I.M. Pandey, and we solve the problems. And if you ask a student to read a balance sheet, he will not know. You ask a student what is a goodwill, he will not know. You ask a student what is merger and acquisition, he will not know. But at the end of the day, again, balance sheet may not tally at all for him. All these are the issues we have. I'm just taking as one example, but there could be a lot of other things actually. Next one is, in your own subject, are there any innovative methods to look into it? It's not the same way of doing things. There could be a lot of innovative methods. Can you look into that? Then the other one could be, can you link your whole of your learning of a student with the industry? Industry institution symbiosis, can you do it? Then can you incorporate, as per the new education policy? They say that the liberal education is going to add a holistic way of thinking for a student. An engineer has to study, let us say, an art part. An art student has to study the technology part. I think that's the meaning. So can we do that? And then finally, we do a lot of co-curricular activities. I am not taking the extracurricular activities like sports and cultural activities. I'm taking the co-curricular activities. Can I make all these things totally into one? We have identified actually almost around 50 methods, and under each maybe 10 to 12 methods, which I'm going to explain to you. If you can do that, I feel the purpose of whole of our learning of a student would be much higher. This could be done only if your teaching in the class gets reduced. Please take it from me. Because today in Google, so much information is available. Better videos of what I'm teaching would be available in the websites already. So why are you trying to spend more time only on that? Give all these things, say they can refer to the common material available, but let them try to spend more time on these things, what I'm going to look for. Let me go on by one. Course augmentation methods. That means you have a particular course X, and then you look into what all the other things to be added to these courses so that his learning would be better. So the best teachers are those who show where to look, but don't tell what to see. I think it's a beautiful statement. So we are mostly interested in what to see. Actually, where to look is very, very important. Then a student will develop a curiosity and start looking into it. What are these course augmentation methods? Of course, we cannot still come out of tests and quizzes. If you want to understand whether a student has understood a knowledge or not, tests and quizzes are essential. But the way you conduct the test, you can look into it. Where you conduct a quiz, can you make it into online? Can you make it in every class? Can you ask students to prepare a questions and ask them to prepare the quizzes? There are a lot of ways to do all those things. Then, of course, a case study based approach. I'm sure that in commerce and management colleges, people try to use these case studies. But I'm very sorry to inform you that this method of learning, people are not doing well. They're left and right writing the answers. without the purpose of what is expected out of a case study. Case study will have a research, a data, condition, hypothesis is going to apply. There are different methods, in-depth analysis they can make, they can analyze and give a result. This is a step-by-step procedure of a case study. So this is another way you can make students understand things in a better way. Seminar courses. I'm sure these seminars are conducted, but problem is, I'm sure even in your colleges, you try to find students won't come until things you make compulsory. Even in a seminar, a best lecture, people will not listen today. What do you do for that? So what you should do is, can you link this with your marks? And each seminar related to a subject, you can set 2-3 questions of that seminar and make sure that students have to answer those 5 questions, and you answer all these things for their marks. Automatically, you don't even call them. They'll come and attend to the seminars. Then can you give a mind-boggling problems to the students? See, you should make people to think today. You have to make people to think today. Can you ask, let us say, Swiggy, McDonald's, Uber's, how their whole business model operates today? How many of the students would be knowing? Because we have all been teaching them the traditional operations management, traditional marketing management, traditional financial management. But today's whole management and business perspectives have changed. We were all taught that if you want to be in logistics or in a transportation business, you are supposed to own the trucks, own the ship, or own the aircrafts, own the buses. But that fundamental concept itself has changed today. Uber or Ola doesn't have any vehicles at all, but they are doing the extraordinary business in the transportation. So this is the paradigm shift which is happening in the society or in the industry. So can you give such problems, mind-boggling problems, and ask the students to look into all these things and find out how they are doing all these things? Of course, we follow in our college a seminar video presentation. See, first method is a seminar method. In seminar method, what happens? You expect students to sit in a class and then try to do things, correct? But here what happens? Faculty have to sit for 7-8 hours and continuously go on evaluating. If you assign 2 faculty, one faculty will be going for some work, other faculty will be sitting. The evaluation doesn't happen correctly. Students keep on coming and going. All such problems are there. But what we are doing in our college is we'll give them a topic and we ask the students to prepare a video and submit it to us. It's a very good habit actually. See, you give a topic and ask him to submit a video. Let us say you give a topic on goodwill and ask him to prepare a video. You know, if you ask a student to do this, you know, what are the things you are teaching these people? If I want to do a video, obviously he'll get neatly dressed. He has to prepare a script very neatly, where written communication is going to improve. Then he has to search for good information. Then he has to deliver. So many things are going to happen through video presentation. So can we ask our students to prepare a 10 minutes video? Because we are always interested, students should present for 1 hour. But in 1 hour, if you take the essence, not even 10 minutes would be very effective. That fellow will copy and paste from the Google and keep on giving all the things which is not at all useful to you, him or as well as us. Precisely, whatever is the work he is doing, can you show through a video? This already many people, IIT Guwahati, or many of the IITs, many of the institutions in the country already have started using these things. We also in our college, for some of the subjects, in order to shrink the time, we ask the students to do a videos and then send them. Faculty during their leisure time are going to look it. If it is good, they'll give the marks. Otherwise, they'll send the comment. Then the video has to be re-prepared and sent it. So this is another method you can look into. Next is the content development. This is very important. Can anybody expect the student can write a book? Because even many faculty might not have written a book. We cannot even accept that a student can write a book. Let me tell you, in my college, there's one student in telecommunication. He's in the final year now. And he has written 10 chapters on Vedic mathematics, which we are going to publish it as a book. So is this possible or not? is the one which you have to look into. So can we ask student to do a content development and you help them? Actually, if you can help them, then it's going to be helpful to the student. Student writing a book, I think it will be very, very good for you, according to me. So that is one more thing you can look into, that the content or the development by a student, can we give it as an assignment? Let us say there is a new area which has come as a digital marketing. Can you involve some 10 students and ask them to prepare different content? Being a faculty, you consolidate it and publish as a book, give acknowledgement to all the students who are involved in the work. See, the main problem is that many people don't acknowledge. If you acknowledge, anybody would be in a position to work. And today's students are very, very selfish. If he gets something, then only he does. Otherwise, he will not do anything. Either he should get the marks, he should get the credits, he should be helpful for, let us say, his higher studies, he should be helpful for his job, then only he will do the things. So we should also become very smart to deal with such students and make sure that he can develop a content also. Can you look into the literature survey? Ask the students to do a literature survey. It's not just copy and paste. Then can you ask your students to take the NPTEL or the MOOC courses, which is possible, so that a related course can be taken by a student so that he's learning. See, at the end of the day, I should not assume I am the best teacher, I know everything. Learning may not happen for a student. There are a lot of other such things. If you can augment, then try to do it, it will be very, very good for him. Then handbooks. Of course, I'm not sure in the commerce area, how much of it is going to come. Let me take one subject on probability and statistics. I'm sure all of you would be teaching this subject. So when you are teaching the probability and statistics, we are expecting students to remember around 300, 400 formulae. What the many people fail also in this subject. So since they're failing in the subject, no, people want to remove that subject itself. I think that's the way we are. So can you prepare a formula handbook and give it to him? A student at the end of the day should know what formula to be used for what purpose. Is as simple as that. He's not mugging up the formula. Why should he mug up the formula? In reality, when you are going to a company, everything is available to you in an open source forum. You can ask anybody, you can look into the books, you can try to understand by yourself. So why so much restriction you want to have? All the form, in fact, in my college, all the related formula of the subjects, we are making a handbook and giving it to a student, because that is a lower order skill of remembering. Higher order skill is, with all these things, in fact, students know, they don't know when to use binomial distribution, when to use Poisson distribution. With so much of our telling and memory based, people don't know about it. So why you want to unnecessarily mug them up, give 400 formula probability statistics, but give very good problem so that if he doesn't think, he will not know what formula to apply. I think that is should be our way of outcome-based education. Then can you look into the Viva on a specific topic for a student? That is, Viva means we always feel it is for the projects. Need not be. In every course, we can try to look into a Viva function. Can you ask your students to prepare brochures, pamphlets about a particular course? It is possible. Give some marks. We have a combination of all these things for 30 or 40 marks, and give them a student a combination of all those things. They'll do a marvelous and a fantastic work. But our problem is, brochures are only for functions. We don't consider. This fellow has to struggle, again study for the test, again do some assignment, then only he'll get the marks. See, learning is like this. Whole informal learning is much more, according to me, what students do in institutions. So can you formalize all this into this experiential learning method? Is very, very important for all of us. So similarly, collaborative writing. I already told you, content development or writing a book, both should be possible, according to me. And then, are there any other innovative creative learning methods which augments the learning of a student in a particular course? And the combination of these things can work. Like say, if a financial management, the method you have to use could be different. If a marketing management, the ways you have to use would be different. So a faculty have to sit and try to look into what would be more applicable. So that's the first category. That means which is going to augment the learning in a specific course. Next category is innovative methods. Today, people are looking for a lot of innovation in every area. Can you allow experimentation? Don't think science and engineering only has got experimentation. Even the commerce, the management has got experimentation. It will be in a different way altogether. It may not be a pipette and burette or a microscope, but I'm sure that faculty who are working under management and commerce should also look into how the experimentations could be conducted in a business scenario. It's not just case study. Here I am looking at the experimentation of a particular. Can you create a total kind of a business scenario of a how Ola operates, how Uber operates, how McDonald's operates? Can you create a total business scenario of that? That could become an experimentation for which you can use the simulation softwares which are available in the market. Another important thing is the design thinking approach. We have a 2 credits lab on design thinking approach. We follow a 5-step methodology. In this, what happens is you try to take a societal problem. We follow a 5-step methodology called empathize, define, ideate, prototype, and test. It's a 5-step methodology. So this another method which is innovative for finding out, let us say, a traffic problem in Bangalore, a garbage system, a waste disposal in a city, or could be how to avoid the global warming. It could be in a bigger. Then how you are going to find out newer batteries in the market? How can you use IoT, Internet of Things, for some of the activities? So design thinking approach is applicable everywhere. It is available in the HR function. It could be applied in financial function. It could be applied in strategic management level. It could be applied. It's a 5-step methodology. It's from outside to the inside. Go to the society, get the problem, come back, and then try to solve the problem. So a very good approach, which we are using every year, the design thinking as a 2-credit course. Then demonstration. Very important is that we should ask people to use the things. Let us say you have explained a balance sheet for a commonly all your accounts you'll be explaining. Can you ask one group of students to find out what all the important components which come in the automobile company balance sheet? What are the things which predominantly come in, let us say, a software company? What are the things which predominantly come in aircraft industry? Are we doing all those things as a demonstration in the our whole of the your preparation of the initial accounts and the final accounts, starting from the journal entry to ledger entry to trial balance to profit and loss account to trading account to the balance sheet? So initial accounts and the final accounts, are we really doing? Demonstration means you can also use a tally software. Ask the student to learn a tally software in finance. Then it's going to become very easy. So you add marks in whatever way you want. You can do that. Then virtual experiment. Can you create a remote experiment virtually? Virtual reality, augmented reality are very, very important today in the market. Can you create a virtual environment of a whole banking transaction you want to create? Can you create virtually and explain to the student? It becomes very easy. Let's say you want to explain a blockchain technology in a financial company. How do you do it? Can you create a virtual or a remote experiment and so that the students will understand in a better way? There's an innovative method of looking into it. In spite of you are doing commerce, business, science, and engineering, Python and R programming are very, very important today. You can give R programming where all the statistical methods could be done through R programming, and Python coding would be very much helpful for you to get some outputs. So are we teaching the students on all those things? Give a new kind of a problem, then ask them to do it. And of course, MATLAB is a very, very good tool which could be used for solving the existing problems or for a new problem. So all these things could then open-ended questions or the experiments. Can you give in your own subject open-ended experiments or innovation in motivating a course? Some courses students don't show interest at all. I think being faculty, you'll be knowing already what courses student doesn't show interest. How do you motivate student? This is the biggest challenge for a teacher, no? So can you ask students only to develop that how you are going to motivate in a course? I attended actually in one of the German consulate a meeting. It was to motivate about civil engineering. There are 2 people who had come to motivate why students have to study civil engineering. Half an hour video was there. They have taken Burj Khalifa in Dubai, whatever is there, as an example. They dissected everything and showed that how important it is. What is the role of a civil engineer? Anybody would join civil engineering if you see that video. It is like that. But who are those two people is very, very important. One person was a very senior professor in Germany in civil engineering. But he not good in making videos, making scripts. He know how to teach in a better way. You know whom he has taken? He has taken a film director with him. Can you even imagine that in your course, a film director would be helpful to you if you want to create some videos? We don't even think this is called as transdisciplinary, multidisciplinary, interdisciplinary, what people are talking about. So can a doctor and an engineer work together? Can a business person with a commerce, can they work together? Can you expect an engineer and a manager to work together? Can you expect randomly a hotel expert working with an accountant? This is the way that multidisciplinary nature we have to build into. Then of course you conduct, I'm sure many of the institutions conduct these ideathons, hackathons, mechathons. But what I feel is you should be focused, subject-wise focused things. In fact, one of my faculty in my college, in one of his course, he conducts hackathon every semester whenever he's handling a course. Subject he handles is computer networks. And for that network, we have a 40 marks for the assignments and seminars and experiential learning. And he conducts a hackathon. There are 180 students. Everybody participates in that, and 24 hours hackathon he conducts by giving a specific problems in the network to each of the groups. And he gives marks based on that. So that's the way we should try to look into. Then product development. Can you ask your student to develop a product? Product means don't think it's only an engineering product, pen or a mobile phone. It could be your financial instrument also could be a product. A software for HR could also be a product. So can you look into this product development, which is what is our Atmanirbhar Bharat is looking at? We need an Indianized product, not some other product getting from outside and trying to sell in India. We need for our own use so that the cost will also be less, the usability will also be very high. So these are the innovative methods of experiential learning, which we can look into. Next, another thing is industry institute symbiosis or the interaction. What are those methods? Industrial visits. Are we really organizing industrial visits? Yes. Many times they go some industrial visit and come back. I'm sure Shillong is a very good place, but they go for some picnic spot and come back. They visit some industry and come back. But are you taking a report after they visit the industry? If you're taking a report, add it to your credit, add it to your marks, then they will do very good reporting. They will see the things in very detail when they go to the company. You give an objective of the industrial visits very clearly, then it's going to happen. Similarly, industrial tours. Like say, 4 or 5 visits, interestingly, and ask the people whoever gets the best report of all these industrial tools will get the highest S grade. So like that, it goes on. I am sure all of you organize expert lectures, guest lecture from the industry people. But here, what we are doing in our college now is, don't call an expert and ask him, sir, whatever topic you want, you can give lecture. I think that's what we do for people. Actually, don't do that. You take a syllabus. Ask him to do one unit, whatever is the specialization you have. And you ask your faculty to sit there. Let them prepare 5 to 10 questions. After every expert lecture, you can conduct a quiz. That quiz could be added. Because why I'm telling all this is, generally we try to spend more time in actually spending separate time on the quiz and the tests. That could be avoided if you can integrate with all those things. And at the end of a semester, you might have conducted, let us say, some 10 lectures, I mean, one industrial visit, all the things put together, you might be having, let us say, 100 marks, which you want to reduce to 20 or 30 marks. It becomes very easy for you now. So that's the way we should try to look into. Even you call an expert, call for a subject. The name itself suggests it's an expert. Don't call for general talks. It will not add any value. I've seen people will come and keep on talking at the end, they'll go away. But if you call subject wise, say that this is a part of your academics and you are supposed to answer the quiz at the end or a test at the end, then people will show more interest. You can ask the expert himself to give 5 questions before only, put it as a Google forum. As soon as the lecture is over, ask the students to fill the answers in a Google forum. Very simple. All the things get stored now. The marks could be very, very easily evaluated at the end of the semester. Industrial problem solving. Can you ask the problem solving by the industries? I don't know whether your college is participating in this hackathons conducted by AICTE every year. 9 to 10 ministries give the problems of their ministries. It could be railways, it could be shipping, it could be industries and commerce. So many problems are given. Can you give these problems to the students and ask them to solve? One important information is Tata's group every year puts the problem solving. There now also you can go and check it. If you go to Tata group, a lot of problems would be available. Anybody can solve the problem. They'll give 10 lakhs, 20 lakhs, 30 lakhs. You can solve the problem. That is the way we should try to involve students in solving an industrial problem, because there'll be a lot of learning. Problem solving is not so easy. He may have to learn a lot of other things if he wants to do that. So then his learning becomes very, very easy. So can you also look into a survey with the industry people as a particular topic in a course? You can give it. Then they will come out with a lot of things. Another important thing which is missing, maybe better in commerce and business institutions, but in engineering, little bit free is we don't make a lot of sectoral analysis. That means if you take McKinsey's classification, there are 22 different sectors of economy as far as the industry classifications are concerned. Does our students know about all these sectors? That itself may not be known. Can you give for finance for agricultural sector for one group, finance for the B2B markets for some other group, finance for automobile sector for some other group, and just randomly giving some examples? Can you ask students to study the HR practices in OLAs? Can you ask them to study HR practices in a hospitality industry, in a hotel industry, the hospital industry, traditional organizations? Can you ask them to do it? These all the industry getting connected very easily. Then of course the mini projects could be done very well. If a student can go and do the projects in the industries, then expert interviews. Can you ask your students to go and do an expert interview? Let us say suddenly you want to know about blockchain technology. There is one expert in Shillong. Can you send a group of students? They have to prepare a questionnaire, interview them, then get the answers. They have to submit a report. Let me tell you, the way students prepare is extraordinarily. They prepare the questions. There are a lot of things to study from the Google. This will add to their learning. Then automatically, if they submit a report to you, please add some marks, 2 marks, 5 marks, 3 marks, it doesn't matter. If you can do that, their learning would be much more. And of course, can you ask the students to do a survey on the startups? What are the things available in your own place or some other place? In Bangalore, we have 7,500 startups. So it's very easy for me to ask an electronics engineer, go there and look into what are the things which is there for him. It could be an electronic system design. It could be an IoT. It could be on cyber security. It could be on blockchains. It could be on robotics. I can ask students to do a lot of survey, because if you do a survey on the startups, all the innovative practices, whatever they're doing, is going to be helpful to a student. Then can you make student a professional association member? It could be All India Management Association. Let them get connected. Our Computer Society of India, Institution of Engineers, you can do that, which will be helpful actually. They can meet a lot of people and try to understand their things. Then virtual internship, can you ask the students to do virtually? Then finally, internship in a specific course. If somebody is teaching, let us say, financial analysis, send for an internship only for that. So now we are advocating in our college, if somebody is teaching electronic circuits or a metal casting, they should go for internship only for that particular thing. It's not a general project. If we can do that, then things becomes very, very important for us. So these are the things which are the third category of industry institution symbiosis. Then the fourth one is liberal arts. I'm sure that national education policy focuses more on the liberal arts in a higher education. A liberal arts education is at the heart of a civil society, and at the heart of a liberal education is the act of teaching. So how do you take care of liberal arts? So in every thing, whatever you do, can you involve students in reading and presenting? See, it's not general debates. In your own course, whatever you are teaching, you can ask a debating to be done. You can ask them to do a role play. You can ask them to read. In fact, in our college, two departments have got a reading club itself. Biotechnology people read biotechnology books and start discussing in their reading club. So can you do that? Debating. Debate means we always feel it's a political debate. Actually, it need not be. Let us say automation. Is it useful for India or not? What are the plus and minus of that? An engineer can discuss and submit a report. It is possible. So there what happens? You'll have to know the communication, the oral communication, the written communication, the knowledge he has about a subject, the way he understands the things, the statistics he's going to give. Oh God, so many things could be tested in all those things. Of course, you can put themselves into a role play is another method. Then you can ask them to do a group discussion. You can ask them to do a cognitive maps, which is a part of a liberal education, so that visually they can try to represent a particular process or a concept. Then you can ask them to do an extended essay writing in a particular topic so that it will be helpful for their better learning. Then you can ask them to do a news article. How many of us encourage a news article in a student? It's not that whenever he wins a prize, we ask them to do it. I give something, it's not that. Can a student do for students? Write about a particular thing happening in the technology or in their area as a part of a news publications in the education columns or whatever it is. You consider it. That is a very, very good, because it is helping that fellow to learn how to write in the newspaper. It is helping, it's an advertisement for the college. It's advertisement for the teachers and the students. So many things are there if we can do that. So can you ask students to do a newsletter, news articles, or in the website or in the podcast? So many social media is also there nowadays. Can you ask the students to do it? And then can you ask the student to do a visual communication? Anything can be represented through a diagram, a chart, a video. Can we ask our students to do that? So these all could be a part of the liberal education, what we talk about. Then can you also ask the students to do a peer mentoring? In fact, this happens in the college, whether we like it or not. One student, before the day of the examination, 9:30 is the exam. Any college you take in the country, 8:30 people will be sitting in group and studying. One fellow will be explaining to the others, all the other 4 or 5 people. In 1 hour, they capture so many things. So peer mentoring, an informal way of learning, is one of the most important things. In our college, we have started a practice of a senior teaching a software to a junior in a class for 1 week. We are doing that. It is possible. Then ask the students to look into the TEDx talks. Extraordinary talks are available in TEDx. Ask them to analyze and give a report to you on the TEDx talks. These are some of the things you can look into on the liberal education. Liberal education means I'm not asking them to do dancing, sports. I'm not talking about that. A liberal way of experience and learning, I'm looking into it and asking the students to do it, so that he's, whether he's doing commerce, science, or engineering, would be very much helpful to him. Then finally, co-curricular activities. I'm not talking in extracurricular activities. Co-curricular activities, what are these things? Journal writing, conference attending, symposium. As of now, let me tell you, very few students will be doing that. Many of the faculty anyway does that. So can you allow your students to do all those things? And as a part of the academics, you can make it in our college, final year project, out of 100 marks, we have 10 marks for journal publication. If a student can publish in a journal or present in a conference, you'll get 10 marks. So can you make it as a part of your academics? It is possible. Attending to a symposium, or could be writing a white paper in a high-tech areas. Could be another poster presentations people can make. Then they can go to the exhibitions actually. present themselves. This is also a co-curricular. All these things, I am sure many college students are doing it, but we are not taking this as a part of our academics. We are not giving marks to a student. We feel because that fellow is attending to exhibition, here you give shortage of attendance to a student. Whereas his learning is much more there than in the class, but we don't give him a marks at all. So I think now a time has come. A learning is not just in the classroom. Holistically, if a student can do all those things, then his learning would be much better. I think that's the intention of the experiential learning method. So if you can just count all those things, it's going to come to almost from 49 to 50 actually methods we have identified. And already in the first year, some of the jigsaw puzzle of the methods, based on whatever the group of faculty feel, they've already even given a list of experiential learning methods course-wise, what students can select. Give a choice to a student, because the learning style of a student is different. Somebody may be good in visual. He will do poster presentation. Somebody is good in the mathematics. He will select some innovative experimentation. So like that, we have to give a chance to the student or a choice to the student for the selection, so that at the end of the day, his learning very good. His learning is very good. So that's what I wanted to convey through these experiential learning methods. So in summary, I'd like to inform you that experiential learning enhances the student's learnability and attainment. Measurement is easy. Combination of the ways of experiential learning to be adopted to impact the outcome-based education. Student learning style is kept in mind, very, very important. And continuous learning and assessment is easy, because we talk about continuous learning, but we still do test quizzes, 3 tests, 2 quizzes, then give the mark. That's not continuous learning. We have to see the continuous learning of a student on a daily basis, actually. If you try to learn all those things, I feel your continuous assessment and learning happens beautifully. But one of the most important factor here is what? Faculty's prayer preparation and research is the key. Otherwise, we'll be diluting all the things. Faculty should set a goal, and what they want to get out of experiential learning, we have to do it. Adapting blended learning becomes easy, which is a new normal. And any other method of experiential learning you are following for a better learning environment, you can add to the list whatever I have given. I don't say these are the only things, but I feel that there may be a lot of other things which may be there. But whatever has come to my mind, I've done a lot of research in this area, maybe over the last 2-3 years, and I have consolidated and segregated into some of these points, which we are trying to use in our college. So, so that what happens when you're doing a curriculum design, your outcome-based education, when you're trying to explain to a student, then your program attainment, course attainments, everything becomes easier. Now what we are doing is we are doing a post-mortem report of all these things. We have not done all these things, and then finally we want to check all this. That's where we are facing a problem. But if you do experiential learning huge way, I'll tell you, your NAAC rating, NBA rating, NARF rating, everything will improve automatically. Don't let us not work for the accreditation and the rankings. If you try to do this in a long way, I feel students will be our ambassadors, and they do their job very well. So this is one precise thing. A lot of other things also could be interdisciplinary research and innovation, liberal education courses itself, what should be taught, then sustainable development goals, then outcome-based education in a fuller sense, and the technology enhancements, what you have to do. There are a lot of other things which can be, we can go on discussing over years and years. So, but I selected a specific topic on experiential learning so that this could be implemented in whatever courses each faculty are teaching here, and so that it is going to be helpful for the students. So this is what I wanted to inform you. Thank you very much. I don't know whether I made some sense to all of you, because this was a post-lens session. It will be always very difficult to do things. I hope I made some difference in this 1 hour for the faculty, so that you can take it forward, and you can also come out with a lot of, let us say, newer methods, so that our students learn things in a better way. So with this, let me once again thank the Shillong Commerce College for giving me opportunity to share some of my thoughts. Maybe let us get connected. I don't know who all the people who are there here, but we should all try to get connected. I am sure that Shillong has got a lot of natural things which we don't have in cities.
Yes.
So can we get connected with the people from Shillong, visit our college, we will come to your colleges and try to have interdisciplinary collaboration. We can do projects, we can have faculty exchange, your students can come and do projects in our colleges, Our students can come and stay there and learn some newer things and innovative way of doing things. So let us try to see whatever is the government vision of self-reliant India or Atmanirbhar Bharat, what people are looking for. Let us try to do it through our education. Let me tell you, it should be done only through education. No other person can do all those things. Experiential learning methods is one of the most important ways wherein we can try to look into to make our outcome-based education in a better way. Once again, I thank all of you. Let me take some time. If somebody has some questions, I'll be very, very happy to answer. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. So thank you so much, sir, for your enlightened, detailed, discussion on experiential learning. Anyone has any questions, any comment to make, kindly? Madam Principal? Yeah. Please unmute. Yes, ma'am.
Good afternoon, sir Subramanian.
Good afternoon.
Welcome to this college, sir. First of all, I would like to thank you for joining us and giving me such an enlightening talk, sir.
There is echo. I think all the other people have to mute. Then things will move. I think if many people are sitting in one room, this problem will also happen. So all the other people have to mute except the person who is talking. Then things will be all right. These are all the limitations of the technology. Madam, you have to unmute.
When I unmute, there's an echo.
Yeah.
Okay, sir. Can you hear me, sir, now? It's so echo, I can't hear.
Madam, it is perfect now.
Can you hear me, sir, now?
Yeah, ma'am. Yeah, we can hear you.
I'm using this.
Hello, ma'am. We can hear you. Yes. Hello. Please go ahead.
Sunai de raha hai humko?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Acha. Okay. Sir, your talk was very enlightening, in fact. And I was just talking with one of my colleagues, in fact, with Sir Baburam this afternoon, about the collaborative work that your college and our college could do together. In fact, I was just talking with Sir Baburam about it, that sending our students to institutes like yours, and our students will learn a lot, and your students can come also to our college and to our place, and they can learn a lot. In fact, student exchange program can be, I can think of it. In fact, we can think of it. Of course, we all have to sit together and plan such programs. And I'm sure it will be very fruitful for our students, especially our students who most of them come from the rural areas and economically backward families. So that will be something very good, and I'm really keen on it, sir. Can you hear me, sir?
Yes.
Okay, sir. Yeah. In fact,
actually, idea... madam, yes, what sir? Can be done is there are 2-3 ways of doing it. So the way one would be, I'm sure that even the government is spending a lot of money in the northeastern regions. So yes, can we jointly apply for some good projects related to the exchange programs? We can jointly apply projects training of the faculties for the both the institutions. Exchange projects with the students, if we can start doing it, then I think we can have a long-term collaboration. It is very easy because I have got MOUs with more than 100 companies. And more than 25 institutions are there. We have MOUs. We are a Margadarshan institution for many of the engineering colleges in Karnataka. So for me, from my side, no objection at all. Tomorrow you send a letter, we can start working. No problem at all.
Okay, sir. I will send you a letter, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Sir, going back to the today's session, we being from commerce, although, of course, all the points that you have mentioned, we are not practicing them, but some of them, like, for example, tally. Tally is compulsory for our students. Sir. And in fact, I feel nice to share with you, because of tally, most of our students are getting placed, actually, wherever they go for their interview. Sir.
Correct.
So similarly, like field trip is there, but we do ask them to write a report, and other co-curricular activities are there. But field trips and tally, most importantly, tally, it has been there. Probably ours was the first in the town to make it compulsory for all the students. We being from commerce, we felt that it is absolutely necessary for the students, sir. So it's wonderful, sir, once again, that you have listed so many things. And
sir, let me tell you, I'll add some points here.
Right, sir.
But commerce and business people actually lack in the technological advancements.
True, sir.
Because if they come to cities, if they don't do that, they will lose on the competition.
Yes, sir.
Is one. Second one is, you have to focus more on all the ERP softwares, supply chain softwares, e-commerce softwares. Related to HR modules can be done, marketing modules could be done, financial modules could be done. Because tally is the lowest level.
Right, sir.
All of the finance area.
Yeah, right.
Fine. Yes, and technology area, if you take today, blockchain technology is one of the most important. So does your student know what is blockchain technology? How to write a coding for that in Python? How to use it for the security of your financial data? These are the things which are expected.
Yes, sir.
So some kind of technological things you have to add so that their learning and catching up with the things will be much faster.
Absolutely, sir. So these points we will keep in mind, sir, and we will surely, you know, try to implement. This will remain with us, sir. Thank you once again, sir. And if there is any more questions, we would love to take it. Participants, if we have any questions, please feel free. You can write in the chat box or in the question and answer, or you can directly take the question also. You can talk to us. Anyone is there?
Problem is, it's called the spirit of inquiry. Faculty doesn't ask questions.
Right, sir.
And we expect our students to ask questions.
Right, sir.
Yes.
Okay.
Right, sir. It looks there are no questions, sir.
Yeah.
So I think we'll have to, will you stop it here, sir? Thank you. Thank you.
You come in?
There's one. Yeah. Yeah. Hello. Yeah, please.
Yes, sir. I have one question pertaining to experiential learning. My question, there are two questions for you, sir. Now, is experiential learning applicable in all discipline? Now, if it's not applicable, if you cannot adopt all the parameters of experiential learning in a discipline or in a subject, what are the mechanisms, for us teacher to use or to adopt a technique that will be, fruitful, that will impart educations, that will impart knowledge to students. I think you got my question, sir.
Yeah. See, let me answer. As I've already told you, experiential learning is applicable to all the disciplines. That's point number one. Don't think it's only for technology kind of things. Let me tell you, if you look into the history, Socrates was using experiential learning very effectively. There is something called as a Socratic learning. Okay? What is the mean of experience is what? Whatever you are teaching, you have to experience it. I am teaching balance sheet. I should experience how a balance sheet is prepared in reality. As of now, a commerce teacher, if I give a whole factory data, how many of you will prepare a balance sheet correctly? That's it. So it is applicable everywhere. It could be applicable for an art subject, it's for a science subject, it's for a mathematical subject, all these things are possible. So irrespective of the disciplines, it is possible. So if somebody says it is not possible, maybe you have to discuss with me. I'll tell you how it is possible.
True, sir. True. We don't have any more questions. Anyone? Yes.
Somebody has asked a question here. I agree, experiential learning is the need of the hour. However, can we implement it without giving grades to the students? No. See, today's students are very smart. Okay. So if you don't give marks, they'll not do anything. It's like a carrot and a stick. Fine. If you want to be more effective, add it to the grades. That's what the fundamental mistake we are doing for a long time. He does so many things, but you are not adding it. You let us say, brand him, a second class student. But same fellow goes abroad and starts a company, then you'll say, he's my student. Where is the problem? So why you are not extracting such things here only? Please, that is what they do. In fact, I'll give you an example. We conducted with NTU, Nanotechnological University. One professor had come here. He had brought his MS student to our college. Fine. He stayed here for 1 week. Okay. And that student was helping all my faculty members in doing a software. How to do the experimentation. Then I asked this professor, what this student will get it? He told, already is one credit I will consider for 1 week. He's considering credit, giving the grade. So that's the way it is. So we should, that's how students show interest there in those places. Here, what happens? That fellow plays a sports, he gets a national award, but you'll declare attendance shortage for him.
It has happened.
So it cannot happen like that. You try to augment, change our system to suit the student's requirement, then they'll do a better job.
Yes, sir.
Sir, can I come in again, sir?
Yeah, please.
Sir, your presentation actually is very enlightening, and it's very, has given more insightful. So thank you very much, sir, for that presentation of yours. Now, sir, you were mentioning that in experiential learning, now we require technology, we require industrial visit, which means we need some kind of infrastructure or help support, sir, for experiential learning. So my question is, infrastructure helps in experiential learning? So what about those area where there's no access actually to technology or structure? How do we cope in such a situation, sir?
Correct. I think it's a very good question, because accessibility is a very big problem to the remote places. Fine. So that's why you had to do a lot of networking and collaboration. Fine. If you can do networking and collab, let us say, are you from the same college? Yeah. So if you're from a same college, you can bring, let us say, 30 students from your college to my college. Okay. And stay here for 1 week or 10 days. I will organize industrial visits for you based on your interest, because I know a lot of industries here. Even industries would be very much appreciative of a good collaboration, because I have more than 100 MOUs with the companies. So we cannot sit in one place and say, I don't have accessible, how can I do it? You have to find out innovative ways. This is where network and collaboration would be very much applicable. But in my college only, I got so much resources. It takes 3 days to the whole of my college, all the experiments, what we are doing. So if they just come here, they'll get good idea. Fine. So that's the way you can go ahead. So accessibility can be taken into consideration only if you have collaboration and networking. If you can do that, then things are going to become very easy.
Is there any more questions? Anyone would like to? Yes, please feel free. If we don't have any questions, then maybe may I request Professor J.C. Blah, Vice Principal, to kindly propose a vote of thanks. Professor J.C. Blah, yes.
Okay, a very good afternoon to all of you. As all good things should come to an end, so is the webinar. On this note, it's really an honor and privilege for me to offer a vote of thanks to all who have directly and indirectly contributed to this today's webinar on NEP 2020, A Paradigm Shift, organized by our institute, that is Shillong Commons College. Heartfelt gratitude goes to all the resource persons for sharing their graceful words and valuable views with us yesterday and today. No event can happen without the provision of a vast network of people. I thank all the resource persons for adorning their necessary insight and sharing with us your graceful opinions and findings. A big thank you to Professor A. Majumdar for your efforts towards role of ethics and constitutional value on education. I must mention our deepest sense of appreciation to Professor D. Prasad for his explanation of NEP 2020. Further, we are grateful to Professor Y.S.R. Murthy for demonstrating his understanding and knowledge on NEP and internationalization. I also wish to express my gratitude to Professor K.N. Subramania for excellent coverage on NEP 2020 and experiential learning. My special thank you also goes to Professor Nangri and Professor Mukherjee, the resource persons in yesterday's webinar. We are all inspired by your meaningful, knowledgeable, and informative presentations. Your acceptance and your contributions have really made this webinar exemplary. To our beloved principal, Ma'am Dr. S. Sen, thank you so much, ma'am, for guiding, assisting, and encouraging all of us to get the ball rolling for these 2 days' seminar. For the success we have in conducting the webinar, hats off to you, ma'am. We have been fortunate enough to get the support of the organizing team, the technical team, the teachers and staffs of the college, and all those involved in this webinar. Your tremendous contribution cannot go unheeded. We have also been fortuitous to be backed by a team of very motivated and dedicated colleagues who spared their valuable time, who knew their job, and are result-oriented. I also extend my sincerest thanks to all the participants, for without you, conducting this webinar would not have been fruitful and productive. I sincerely apologize if I have missed out anyone in my thank you speech. To those whom I may have missed, please accept my biggest thank you. With these warm words and a kind message, we move to the end of these 2 days' webinar. Thank you all once again. God bless. Stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you all. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank
we
you.
Will
Thank
meet, you. Sir. We would Thank like you. To host you physically in Shillong. Sir.
Yeah. Yeah, I'll also be happy to come. Yeah, sometimes we'll meet, definitely.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.